Good morning to all. I would like to thank Professor Ugo Carraro for giving me the opportunity of presenting at this conference. I'm currently a PhD student in the laboratory of Prof. Protasi at the University of Chieti, and today I will talk about the project that has been assigned to me for my PhD. I will start by defining what are the environmental heat stroke, or EHS, and marine and hyperthermia susceptibility, or MHS. Environmental heat strokes are crises characterized by abnormal increase in body temperature triggered by high environmental temperature, often triggered when also humidity is elevated. On the other hand, malignant hyperthermia is a genetic disorder characterized by hypermetabolic response to commonly used volatile anesthetics that will may lead to death of patients if crises are not promptly corrected by suspension of triggering agent and administration dantrolene, the only drug approved for the treatment of acute malignant hyperthermia crisis. Interestingly, these two syndromes share similar symptoms, increased oxygen consumption and generation of skeletal muscle tension and rigidity that eventually may lead to rhabdomyolysis of skeletal muscle fibers. A possible link between these two symptoms, between heat strokes and malignant hyperthermia, has been proposed already several years ago as a medical hypothesis. For more than 10 years, the laboratory of Prof. Protasi has been working on project, thanks to funding from the Italian Telethon Onlus and from NIH, on project aiming to unravel the molecular mechanism underlying the rhabdomyolysis during hyperthermic crisis. The current view is that an excessive calcium leak from the sarcoplasmic reticulum induces an excessive production of reactive oxygen species due to mitochondrial overload, a process that is exacerbated under stressing condition like environmental heat, and that involves nitrosylation of the ryanodine receptor type 1, the calcium release channel of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. With this in mind, we developed the following scientific hypothesis. Are there any factors that may increase the risk of healthy people to develop hyperthermic crisis when exposed to environmental heat? Could, for example, high-fat diet be one of the factors that may increase the susceptibility of individuals to heat? Why high-fat diet? Because it is known from literature that a diet rich in lipids may increase oxidative stress. And oxidative stress is one, as I told you in the previous slide, is one of the mechanisms underlying heat strokes. To answer to this question, We divided wild-type mice in two groups, a high-fat diet group fed with a diet rich in lipids, and a control group fed with a diet with low amount of lipids. Both groups at the age of 1 month old started the two diet treatments, and after 3 months, 12 weeks of diet treatment, we performed the different analysis you see listed here. First, we evaluated the food consumption of mice during the diet treatment. And although diet have different composition, as you see in panel A, both groups ate approximately the same amount of show. Nevertheless, the high-fat diet group showed a greater weight gain compared to control group, panel B, mostly due by an increase in adipose tissue, panel C. In panel D and E, you see the adipose tissue dissected from mice with the anatomical reference of the different parts. We then evaluated the basal metabolism of mice by an indirect calorimetry system. In this system, mice are placed inside the chamber in which VO2 consumption and VCO2 production are registered for 24 consecutive hours hours to obtain the plots you see in these graphs, which represents the average of 12 mice per group. The results indicate that high fat diet shifted the basal metabolism of mice. VO2 consumption and basal energy expenditure are both reduced by high fat diet, suggestive of a lower basal metabolism. In panel C, the respiratory quotient, RQ, which is the ratio between VCO2 and VO2, a value shifted toward 0.7 indicates that high fat diet group use more lipids than the control diet group as energetic fuel. The data presented so far were collected after the diet treatment in mice not subjected to environmental stress. However, when we subjected mice to a heat stress protocol, a heat challenge of 41 degrees for 1 hour in the climatic chamber visible in this picture, the measurements of metabolic rate of mice gave opposite results than at rest. VO2 consumption and energy expenditure were both increased in high fat diet group. Since heat strokes are characterized by hyperthermia, we measured the rise in core and skin temperature, collecting temperature before and after the heat stress protocol. Both registrations follow the same trend, and as you can see in these bar graphs, the data obtained show how the mice of high fat diet group reached a higher final temperature compared to that of control diet. This difference was statistically significant. To assess the presence of signs of skeletal muscle damage, because hyperthermic crises are often associated with rhabdomyolysis, we collected blood samples from mice immediately after the heat stress protocol. And we measured by colorimetric reaction plasma levels of potassium, calcium, and creatine kinase, classic blood markers of skeletal muscle damage. Plasma collected from high fat diet group showed a slight but significant increase in all the three markers we tested compared to control diet group. In vitro contracture test, IVCT, usually performed in biopsies from patients that have experienced malignant hyperthermia reaction during administration of anesthesia, is the gold standard currently used to diagnose malignant hyperthermia susceptibility in patients. Here, we evaluated the sensitivity to temperature and caffeine in EDL dissected from mice. Caffeine is an agonist of the calcium release channel of the sarcoplasmic reticulum skeletal muscle, the ryanodine receptor type 1, as is commonly used in vitro contracture tests. EDL muscles from high fat diet group showed a higher propensity to undergo contracture compared to control group in response to both heat and caffeine. Finally, we investigated oxidative stress levels by measuring levels of nitrosylated proteins, a direct marker of the effect of oxidative stress in proteins in panel A, and the expression of some antioxidant enzymes, SOD1, SOD2, and catalase, panel B, D. All parameters tested were higher in high fat diet group in muscle homogenates of VDLs from high fat diet groups, which indicates cell exposure to oxidative stress. To conclude, in this slide, we summarized the main result of this work. One, mice fed with high fat diet show a greater increase in body temperature than control group. when exposed to environmental heat. 2, their ideal muscles have a higher propensity to undergo contracture when exposed to both increasing temperature and caffeine. And 3, muscles tissue from high-fat diet group have higher levels of oxidative stress. In conclusion, the data collected in this project suggests that high-fat diet can predispose wild-type mice to environmental heat stroke. If confirmed, this data could somehow be used for guidelines regarding proper food habits in periods of extremely hot climatic condition. I would like to thank all the members of our laboratory, Flavia Guarnier, the funding agencies Teleton and NIH, which provided the financial support, and all of you that are online today.
Thank you, Matteo. Thank you for this very nice task. We have 9 minutes left. Are there questions to Matteo? Hugo.
I remember that you did a lot of studies in which you also measured the amount of problems for the life of the mice. Did you some other in the laboratory did the survival risk for these mice?
No, because we treated the mice only for 3 months. At the age of 4 months old, all the mice survived at this diet treatment protocol. So I don't know if this diet prolonged in time could reduce the life of mice, but.
No, I'm sorry. I am not talking on the extent of life of the mice, but if you induce more often myopathic thermophilia or not? Feliciano, tu mi hai capito?
No, yes, Matteo, I think what Ugo is asking, what happens if mice are subjected to heat stress several times? Do their lifespan changes? Is that the question, Ugo?
Yes.
We didn't do this experiment. In this experiment, we subjected the mice to a diet and verified that if we
plan to do this also, because this will be more clinically relevant.
We haven't thought about this. Matteo actually now is doing another experiment in which instead of doing a heat stress of 1 hour at 41 degrees, is doing an extended stress of 3 days. At 44.
That was my question. If you plan the.
Yeah, we are planning slightly different experiments, but now that you gave us this suggestion, I think this is interesting. What happens if we give heat stress several times in different days?
And if the control are more resistant to the stress than the high diet, this will be astonishing. I think it will.
Very interesting.
It will be a shocking result.
Yeah, nice suggestion. And I think since we have time, why are we doing these studies? Because it's several years that we are studying the molecular basis of environmental and exertional heat stroke. During this meeting this afternoon, we're going to have also a talk on exertional heat stroke. Why are we interested in this? Because the climate is changing. And something that people don't know is that during heat waves, the excess of deaths is huge, is immense. Some phenomena have been studied. For example, one of the better studies is an heat wave in Europe in 2003. Some of us remember those days, 40 days of intense heat. Yes. In France, this environmental phenomena is being studied, and in 40 days, there was an excess of death of 20,000 people. 20,000 people of that dies more than normal, it's a huge number. And this is something that has to be studied. And now we are going toward trying to understand, as we believe the muscle being 50% of the body weight and being the organ that produces heat is involved in this, and we have many molecular data on this, we are trying to see if some habits of humans can be dangerous. For example, non-hydrating ourselves or not eating the right food. Or for example, the data on Matea shows if we give mice a lot of lipids, they become more susceptible to heat stroke. And now another thing we are showing is this afternoon we're gonna have a talk in which we show what happens if we exercise intensively when it's very hot. Animals are intelligent, you know, they hide when it's very hot. While humans, maybe because they have no other time to exercise, they go out and exercise when it's very hot. Is this dangerous? So even in normal people, so that's our line of interest at the moment. And one of the things we're gonna do, we're gonna apply to the European Council for a grant for this.
Good luck to Matteo and to the laboratory. This is really, I believe, very, very important for obesity. If you think how often obese people have shorter life, yes, this could be one of the contributing factors, maybe. Why not?
Yeah, no, we believe it is. Yes. Matteo showed you, in basal condition, the mice which are, they have more body fat because they've been fed a high fat diet, they have a lower oxygen consumption. Matteo also checked that they move much less in the cage.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. But then if we give them heat, they have higher oxygen consumption and higher body temperature, which is a big risk.
Congratulations.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Matteo, you see, the advantage is if your professor is with you, he will answer for you.
No, sorry, Ugo. Ugo involved me in the discussion.
Was just a joke. Are there other questions to Matteo? We have 3 minutes left. Capuchin.
Yes.
Morning to Capuchin, our co-chair.
Sorry, I was a few minutes late. Sorry for that.
Doesn't matter. We were on point.
So I had two questions on this slide. Exactly. So you're saying that you have increase in weight gain. Did you look specifically at the muscle? Is there any increase or decrease in the muscle itself?
No, in muscle, no. I measured the physiological cross-sectional area, and there are no difference between the two groups. No.
And then in your heat shock treatment, you looked at the EDL. Do you see difference if you take the Soleus, for example? Or was there a reason for taking the EDL and not the Soleus to have, you know, fiber type difference and see if you have any change based on the fiber type that you're using?
Yeah, we looked mainly at EDL because in previous studies in our laboratory, we saw that EDL is the most susceptible muscle to its strokes, but okay. I also performed experiments in EDL in Soleus, and as you can see in this slide, oxidative stress levels in Soleus are also elevated in high fat diet group. And I also performed in vitro contracture tests in Soleus, and I obtained the same results. So also okay. the Soleus is susceptible to undergo contracture under heat and caffeine